Hello, CUBE community, and welcome back to the AI Security Summit in San Francisco, California. You're back with Jackie McGuire. I'm the practice lead, principal analyst, and your favorite security host at theCUBE. And I am joined today by Francesca LaBianca. Francesca, welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here.
You are the head of business operations at Factory, yeah?
Correct.
All right, so let's start with, I want to learn a little bit more about you. So tell me a little bit about your background and kind of what led you to Factory.
Yeah, absolutely. So I started my career in investment banking in the tech, media, and telecom space. Shortly moved into venture, really was compelled to work with early stage companies.
I was at SVB, so very
similar background. Awesome. And loved it. Spent all my time investing in startups across AI, cyber, software generally. Mm-hmm. But felt like I wanted to go a bit deeper. Always felt like I wanted to join the team almost. I had invested in a Factory at the fund I was at, which is how I got to know the founders, Matan and Eno. Really loved this space within CodeGen, and also really loved their approach in targeting enterprises. Mm-hmm. So after the Series A, actually Matan called me up and convinced me to join full time. So it's been about a year and almost a half now there, leading up business operations, which is a little bit of everything from partnerships, BD, growth, ops, finance, marketing.
Wow, that just small portfolio of responsibility.
We're small but mighty team.
Yeah, that's one of the things I love. And I, same exact thing. I worked at SVB for like 6 or 7 years and same thing, caught the bug and was like, I have to go do this startup thing. Cause like, it's one thing to see the money they're raising and like be excited by proxy, but it's a whole different thing to actually be in, you know, the day to day and kind of fighting that battle.
Totally.
All right, so tell me a little bit about what Factory does. I know that you guys really help in kind of the software development lifecycle, so maybe kind of a TLDR on what the software development lifecycle is for any of our viewers who aren't familiar, and then tell us about how Factory helps.
Yeah, absolutely. So we are a platform that enables enterprises to accelerate parts of the software development lifecycle with agents. Key to that is it's not just the coding piece, it's really the entire SDLC, because if you focus on just coding, you lead to bottlenecks other parts of the SDLC, and coding is just a small subset of what engineers spend their time on in professional environments. And so we help with everything from understanding a code change, planning the code change, coding it itself, reviewing code, testing code, and maintaining code. And that's kind of how we think about the entire SDLC, all the way from an idea comes up through maintaining that code in prod.
Awesome. Yeah, so one of the statistics that I heard is as people have started to use generative coding assistants, commits have gone up like 6x, but pull requests have not gone up proportionately, and the size of the commits has also gone up exponentially.
Sounds about right. We're
creating thousands of additional lines of code, and humans are most likely not doing a great job reviewing all of that before it's merged into prod, right? So how does Factory help in that case?
Yeah, that's a great question, and we see this a lot. I think one of the initial ways that people try to measure AI and coding and its impacts was with lines of code, but it's not a great metric because you can create infinite lines of code, but is it ready to be merged and all the other things? Does it create other downstream problems? As you mentioned, review becomes a really critical part of this, you know, new process. And really how we think about it at Factory is you're moving from, you know, single human in a IDE writing every line of code to now being able to send a task to an agent, let it run to end to end. And that requires a fundamentally new way of working. And we call this agent-driven development. And it's really, you spec out a task to an agent, much like you would to an engineer on your team, being very thoughtful about how you do that, delegating that task, watching the agent run, seeing everything that it's doing as it pulls in context, calls tools, and then reviewing it. So the role of review becomes super important. We work with a lot of companies on our side too to create one, like on PR automated reviews from agents that can pick up a lot of the low hanging fruit, but the human is still very needed in the loop of review, and that role becomes only more emphasized with, you know, the greater amount of agents you incorporate.
Yeah. And so I've talked to a handful of venture investors over the last several months, and they kind of talk about this dual mandate that the enterprise is trying to handle right now. The first is, you know, integrate AI into the enterprise, you know, buy AI tools and find ways to help, you know, help make the enterprise more productive with existing AI tools. But the other is to make the enterprise AI ready, or as you refer to it, as agent ready. So what does that actually mean to you? And how are you seeing some of your more successful customers do that?
Yeah, great question. We talk about this a lot with our large enterprise customers, especially folks like Ernst & Young, McKinsey, who are helping orgs not just usher in AI coding tools, but really think about how they transform their org to match this new wave. How can you best set up your org so that you can have agents running and they have these very clear guardrails so that their output is better. And we think about this as agent readiness. And this incorporates a number of things, but the initial way companies start is very small, starting with like an agents.md file, which is like an open source standard now amongst many companies, including OpenAI and others, Factory. That sets up rules for your agents as they run, but this extends to how your tests are set up, how your linters are set up, how your dev containers are set up, all these things that are primitives and upstream of letting an agent in your work in your org. And that's not just Factory specific, that's, you know, any coding agents you use within your org become, lead to higher quality output, not necessarily just more lines of code created, but really more like PRs merged with higher code quality.
Do you think this is a bit of an inflection point? So, you know, and anybody who's watching this full set of interviews has heard me say this a few times, but they always say if you ask five engineers how to solve a problem, you'll get seven or eight answers, right? And that's flown in the enterprise for a long time because engineers are, we're magical beings and we need to be able to do our work however we want to. Do you think this is a little bit of an inflection point to start to establish more consistency and standards across how we solve problems and how we build things?
Yeah, super interesting question. I think the creativity piece will still remain because, like I mentioned, there's kind of this role at the beginning of the process, which is speccing it out. So that is where the human is very in the loop. There's creativity involved. You're telling the agent how you're thinking about a problem. It'll think on new ways on how to solve that as well. And it's non-deterministic, so that may not always be the same case. But you do still have these guardrails for how this it's stylized, how it'll fit within your broader SDLC. So I do see how in some cases, yeah, there might be much similar to how, you know, you may feel like if you use ChatGPT for writing, it all sounds the same. It will definitely standardize some of that, but there will still be that creativity, especially in the beginning with spec and at the end with reviewing the code.
Yeah. All right, so what's your advice? If I'm, let's say I'm in your role at a company who's trying to make itself agent ready, what do you think are the one or two kind of low-hanging pieces of fruit that most companies should start to tackle first in terms of getting ready for bringing agents into the enterprise?
Yeah, I think
other than calling you.
Yeah, first call Factory. Yeah. Secondly, I would say really setting up your tests and linters to have full coverage to make sure that they are incorporating all the right rules there is the first thing you can do. And that's like the first line of defense. That's no different than pre-AI coding, right? And that's like very critical to, for your engineering org. But if you have those guardrails up to start, then it's super helpful, along with your like agents.md file that agents can very clearly follow. Those are kind of the first three steps we help cover, and then there are some ones as we get deeper into the process.
And then looking forward, we ask people this question a lot. So let's say we sit down next year at the AI Security Summit Part 2. What do you hope to be able to say that Factory's accomplished? So what's on your roadmap for the next kind of 6 to 12 months? And I know everything changes every 30 days now, and the world as we know it is very uncertain. But ideally, we'll be sitting here next year, and what do you want to be able to tell us?
Yeah, our mission at a high level is to bring autonomy to software engineering. And in a year's time, obviously model capabilities will develop, agentic capabilities will develop, our product suite will continue to develop. I think the greater amount of time we can save engineers to free up their time to work on the creative aspects of software engineering, systems design, building things out, coding is even the core piece that they love, and not have to do the mundane things like review and test and documentation. That is really what we set out to achieve, and the more that we can do that at scale for enterprises is what we'd love to achieve in the next year.
Yeah, coming from data science, I would be more than happy to let an agent take care of the last like 5% of tuning my models, where it's just beating my face against a Jupyter notebook trying to make them
better.
So also annotating my code, because I'm usually terrible at that. So I would love to have an agent that actually tells people what I thought I was doing when I was writing something.
Yep.
So to take a look at it from the investor side, since you have great experience there, I think a lot of companies right now, because you know, potential enterprise customers are not necessarily as well versed in AI, what guidance can you give leaders at companies looking to bring in vendors on how to tell the difference between an AI company riding a hype wave and the companies who are out there really making a difference? So as an investor, when you were trying to find companies to invest in, how do you separate the...
Yeah, good question.
The way.
I think it's all in the product feedback. Developers vote with their feet. Are they using the tool? Do they like it? Do they not? Mm-hmm. That is really the truth of it all. And I think that is how investors can parse through the noise and the hype. is if you talk to someone, how much time has it saved you? You know, not just lines of code created, but how much has your on-call time dropped? Has, you know, your, has your code, your test coverage increased? These types of things. I think it all really just comes back to user feedback at the end of the day, as early as you can get that as an investor, is what I would say.
Yeah, awesome. Any other, so I know we're both women in tech, so I always like to get the opinion. I'm of the opinion that now is, I mean, there's arguably never been a better time to get into AI and security. And I think, you know, from the perspective of being able to use a coding assistant, I think it's dramatically lowering the barriers of entry for, you know, women, people who might be transitioning from other fields. So do you have guidance for young women who are kind of looking at this and they're a little daunted by the terminology and all of that in terms of, I mean, I just had to kind of dive in when I was young, but you know, what guidance do you have for women who are looking at this and saying, you know, how do I get in on the, how do I take advantage of this insane opportunity and start educating myself?
Yeah, I love this question. For folks who come from a non-technical background, which is part of your question, that's myself. I have absolutely loved being a part of this whole wave. I think there's more opportunity than ever to try new tools. There's so much education out there. People are trying so many different things, posting about it on X, YouTube, the ways in which they use it. And there's never been a better time to just jump in, try things, see what works, see what doesn't. Think about how you can automate the things you're doing. You know, we, on our BizOps team, every process that we have, the first question is like, can we, you know, use Droids, which are our agents, to automate this? And that is like creates a completely new mentality in how you work. And I think that's been something that's a lower, you know, barrier to entry. And for women jumping into AI and tech in general, there's amazing communities of women in AI. I'm part of one, actually, it's called Sapien, shout out to the group. But it's like 200 women operators across the AI startups. And I think you'll find a lot of community in it. And I think that that is just starting to even increase more and compound, and you know, really fun to be a part of.
Did you find that your non-technical background was actually kind of a superpower when you got into this field? Because that was, so while it took me a while to ramp, you know, coming from finance and transitioning into data science and learning how to write Python and all of that, that was tough. But being able to take some of the background I had from finance and apply frameworks that were completely unrelated to security and data science, things that I knew from other industries, did you find that there were some transferable things from your non-technical background?
Certainly, certainly. And I think our team, one of our core values at Factory is embrace perspectives. And when I first joined Factory, we were a team of 10, all engineers to date. And it was interesting to bring the perspective of finance. You know, how are we thinking about margins? How are we thinking about compute? How are we thinking about, you know, partnerships with folks like Sneak and others? Like, you have a different type of knowledge set. And now that as we build out the tool, I'm always sending feedback in our engineering CLI channel because I use Droid for all types of non-technical use cases. And non-technical use cases, you know, now they're now technical. You know, whether that's like writing JDs to automating our, you know, RevOps stack, like all these types of things. And I think there's certainly superpower in that because now we can also service a broader set of users and use cases as well.
Yeah, so shout out to all the young women out there who are coming from non-technical backgrounds.
Yes.
There are probably organizations who really, really need those skills and will let you learn how to ramp up in the technical roles as
Absolutely.
Well.
We're hiring on the BizOps team at Factory, so yeah. Reach out.
Awesome. Francesca, thank you so much for being here today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. Great to chat.
Thanks. From the AI Security Summit in San Francisco, California, this is Jackie McGuire for theCUBE, your source for tech news and analysis.